Hi, I'm Dr. Mythri Shankar. I'm a nuclear medicine physician, senior consultant at Cytecare Cancer Hospital, Bengaluru. PET-CT is a new imaging, hybrid imaging modality, if you will, and it's mainly used in staging of the cancer in the scope of head and neck cancers in particular. It's excellent to stage the patient, meaning how far the cancer has spread. You're looking at TNM staging, the entire T stage, which is the tumor extent and the nodal involvement, be it the cervical lymph nodes or the metastasis into distant parts of the body, particularly in the mediastinal lymph nodes or the lungs or any other part which that particular tumor would spread to. Most common sites would be the lungs, the bones, the brain, and PET-CT scans offer a one-stop scan, if you will, from head to mid-thigh, where we can image the entire body and check for increased foci of metabolic activity or glycolysis, which indicate the presence of tumor in those areas. It's also very good for restaging, as in the patient has undergone some kind of a treatment, be it surgery, be it radiation therapy, any other kind of chemotherapy, to assess how well the patient has responded to that particular type of treatment. We look for fall in activity, the glycolytic activity comes down, which helps us assess the treatment response or a metabolic level, be it partial or complete. And something new which we are seeing or trying to explore in head and neck cancer is the tumor volume estimation while giving radiation therapy to that particular tumor. Typically, until now, we have been using CT volume, CT-based volume estimation, but now there is a little bit more value add PET-CT could bring into the picture by estimating the tumor volume to be a little different than the CT estimated volumes. It could do two things. It could allow us to cover more area of treatment or give lesser amount of radiation, therefore preventing complications which could happen from radiation therapy. Thyroid forms a very integral part. Thyroid cancers form a very important group of head and neck cancers, and they are a little different when you compare them to other head and neck cancers. The point being, they are excruciatingly iodine sensitive. They pick up iodine, and we have a lot of scans in nuclear medicine which use iodine, just like PET-CT, to stage the patient, the extent of disease in the patient, and that is what we have been using so far. But now, sometimes what we have seen is certain types of thyroid cancers differentiate. The differentiated kinds of thyroid cancer do not pick up iodine as well as some of the other common groups do. So in such cases, when we measure certain markers in the blood, be it thyroglobulin, things like that, we see that there is chemical presence of cancer, but they're not picking up iodine. So we need to still go ahead and check how far the cancer has spread. And these cancers are not iodine avid. So there is a term what we call TENIS, T-E-N-I-S, which is thyroglobulin elevated, negative iodine scan. So meaning the thyroglobulin is high, iodine scan is low, and we still don't know the stage of the cancer. So such group of patients can benefit from what we call a FDG PET scan, which measures the glycolytic activity in the tumor cells and not the iodine avidity, and therefore helps us stage the patient better and also gives us a platform to treat it better if it has spread to the lungs or to the brain, so on and so forth. So it forms a very integral part of staging, particularly in thyroid cancer. Other than diagnostics, well, nuclear medicine is basically use of radioisotopes within the human body. We use it both for diagnostic and therapeutic purposes. We can diagnose using it in scans, and we can also use it in treating the patient. Radioiodine ablation has been the mainstream of the theranostics, it's called theranostics, just like diagnostics, where we use it for therapy, theranostics aspects of nuclear medicine. And when we do a radioiodine ablation in thyroid cancer, there is also a concept where we use a recomp TSH. We use that to stimulate the uptake of the radioiodine therapy which we give. And it not only makes the procedure faster, we don't have to wait for long times for the TSH levels to change, and also allows us to do it in a shorter duration. And that is something very, which is not new, it's been there for a while, and I think more and more people are catching it and starting to use it. Except for the cost factor, it's a great tool to have where we can use exogenous TSH, recombinant TSH, to stimulate the gland and also use radioiodine therapy in a better way. So what we give essentially goes and sticks in the thyroid better and then irradiates the thyroid better. So this is something new in the context of nuclear medicine in thyroid disease. Along with that, we are seeing a lot of newer isotopes, be it lutetium, be it MIBG, for several other isotopes being used with a therapeutic, used in therapy per se, for cancers like pheochromocytoma in the adrenal glands, or prostate cancer, or we even have samarium available for palliative bone pain in patients having metastatic bone lesions from breast and prostate cancer, etc. Futuristically, I think we are seeing a lot more nuclear medicine and PET CT scan centers in India. For example, when I moved back to India from the US about 10 years ago, there were quite a handful of PET CT centers, maybe less than 10, I would say, in the entire country. Today, I think we are close to 200, and just in Bangalore, we have quite close to 10 a combination of nuclear medicine and PET CT centers, I would say. And amongst these centers, about three or four of them are making available the latest technology in terms of TARE, which is trans-arterial embolization, radioembolization of a certain kind of liver tumors, and be it lutetium or MIBG or even rhenium has come into Bangalore recently. So we are seeing a lot of newer isotopes, a lot of finer techniques with more targeted diagnostic and therapeutic capabilities.